Hi, today I am going to discuss about sinusoidal pulse width modulation. Last class I discussed multiple pulse width modulation. There we have seen that output voltage can be controlled by controlling the number of pulses as well as width of each pulse. And in multiple pulse width modulation, we have seen that the width of all the pulses were same. Because of that, harmonics across the output voltage is more. So to get better output voltage quality, sinusoidal pulse width modulation is the most popular one. So let's start. There are more than one pulse per up cycle, so it is also multiple pulse width modulation and known as non-uniform pulse width modulation. Compared to last class, here the width of pulses are not same. That's why the naming is non-uniform pulse width modulation. Instead of maintaining the width of all pulses same, the width of each pulse is varied in proportion to the amplitude of a sine wave. As our purpose is to obtain sinusoidal output voltage, and to get that one, we are filtering our output voltage of the inverter. So if the harmonics across the output voltage is less than our filtering requirement or size of the filter, or you can say inductor and capacitor size will reduce. So it will reduce the cost of the system. That's why this sinusoidal pulse width modulation is more popular. Because of non-uniform pulse width, distortion factor and lowest order harmonics are reduced significantly. Distortion factor means the remaining harmonic across the output voltage after filtering, that is reduced. At the same time, lowest order harmonics is reduced. Lowest order harmonic, you can say the lowest harmonic order having magnitude close to 3% of the fundamental component, so that is reduced. This SPWM technique is preferred in industries. Here our sinusoidal reference signal is compared with high frequency triangular signal to generate the gating pulses. We will see those things. And modulation index is equal to amplitude of reference signal divided by amplitude of carrier signal. First of all, let's see why non-uniform pulse width modulation is required. Here you can see this kind of waveform we want from our inverter. But as switches are to be on off because of that one, exactly this sinusoidal waveform is not possible to obtain. Instead of this kind of output voltage pulses, positive up cycle you can take it as a reference we are getting. But one thing we can do, here you can see here the magnitude of this required output voltage, here it is 0, then slowly the magnitude is increasing. This magnitude is increasing, here the magnitude is maximum, then magnitude is decreasing. So here again the magnitude is more, then it is decreasing. Just for reference I am discussing this one. So what we can do, we can obtain the pulse width of the output voltage in such a way that during this period pulse width is smaller, then slowly the pulse width will increase, and here more output voltage we want, so the pulse width will be more. So if we are able to achieve this one, then we can reduce THD of the output voltage. Here you can see between this and this point, just take as the reference, it is not the actual one, though for understanding point of view we can compare. Here you can see the width of the pulses, here it is slowly increasing, and at this point in this region the width are maximum, then again the width is decreased. So if this kind of output voltage waveform we are able to achieve, then we can say TSD of the output voltage is reduced significantly. So behind this sinusoidal pulse width modulation, this is our purpose. Now to obtain that one, here also two kinds of signals are used. First one is your carrier signal, high frequency carrier signal is used. Then a reference signal is itself a sinusoidal signal. Then what will happen? You will see when the carrier signal is more than this reference signal, then you will get the pulse. And when the reference signal is more than the carrier signal, then pulse is absent. Likewise, here also you can see carrier signal is more than reference signal, so pulse you are getting. So advantage of this one is that you will get non-uniform width of the pulses and the pulse width will be more when the sinusoidal output voltage is around its peak point, and at initial point the width of the pulses are less. So these switching pulses have been generated for switch number 1 and 2 of single phase full bridge inverter. So from here we can conclude that a high frequency triangular signal is compared with a reference signal to obtain switching pulses for switch number 1 and 2. Now let's see the switching pulses for switch number 3 and 4. Here just the reverse reference signal is selected, but the carrier signal is same. Now here you can see when the carrier signal is more than reference signal, then you are getting the pulses, and when the reference signal is more, then pulse is absent. So like this switching pulses you will get, you can see, and behind the peak point here this triangular width is more, so more pulse width you are getting. That means for more duration of time our switch number 3 and 4 will remain on. That means across the output voltage for more duration of time we will get V or minus B. So that was the purpose behind this sinusoidal pulse width modulation. So from here we can say by comparing a high frequency carrier signal with a sinusoidal reference signal, we can generate switching pulses for switch number 3 and 4. Now let's apply these switching pulses across single phase full bridge inverter and observe the waveform. Let's see. So here it is our output voltage, and this output voltage you can see here the pulse width is very low or minimum, then pulse width is slowly increasing, and the width of the output voltage here it is more, and this will be around your peak point region, then the width is slowly increased. So you can say from this point to this point here it is pi, then negative of cycle pi to 2 pi. Here also likewise you are getting the switching pulses, and the width of the pulses are not constant, it is varying. Because of this we are getting very low THD across the output voltage, and then we have to filter out this output voltage using LC filter, then the size of that LC filter it will reduce. So this reduces the cost of the complete inverter. That's why this sinusoidal PWM technique is too much popular in industrial application. Similar process is applied for three phase inverter also. In three phase inverter, same carrier signal is compared with three reference signals and those reference signal should be 120 degree out of phase. Then in three phase also we can obtain reduced TSD output voltage. So you can say the switching pulses 1 and 2, likewise output voltage you are getting, and this one is on, here it is B, and 100 volt supply are given, so you are getting this 100 volt. So based on this switching pulses, you are getting this output voltage pulses. Now in 3 and 4, you can see these switching pulses are applied, then output voltage we have got like this, and this magnitude is minus 100 volt. So 100 volt minus 100 volt, that means similar positive half cycle waveform we are getting in negative half cycle. So average output voltage you will get 0. At the same time here also you will get AN is equal to 0. Then you have to find coefficient of sinusoidal signal, and as the pulse width is varying, so based on the number of pulses in one half cycle, you have to develop a program to find this instantaneous output voltage or Fourier analysis of this waveform. For UG level, it is not required, or if you are interested, you can write a program and find the sinusoidal component coefficient, then analyze the output voltage as we have done in case of non-uniform pulse width modulation. So this was our reference signal to generate switching pulses of switch number 1 and 2, and negative of that one we will take reference signal for switch number 3 and 4, but the carrier signal will remain same and the output voltage you are getting like this. So one cycle of output voltage you will see from here to here, and the next half cycle it will start from here. So during this period, if our switch is completely on, or here if we are getting V, then the magnitude of output voltage will be more. Based on that one, modified sinusoidal pulse width modulation is developed, and to generate those kind of switching pulses, that means 1 and 2 should be on for this duration of time and 3 and 4 should be on for this duration of time completely on. That means these pulses are not required, it should be on for this duration of time. It may be 120 degree duration or 60 degree duration. Based on that one, output voltage magnitude will increase. And to generate that one, these switching pulses, we can observe that initial triangular signal we can give, and then after that we will give a constant signal. And to obtain more output voltage around the peak point, you can generate the switching pulses by comparing the signal like this, this, and then it will be a constant signal. Then again the triangular signal will start. Then you will get the switching pulses. Initial switching pulses will remain same, but after that it will be on for some duration of time, and then again it will follow the same pattern as we have got here. So that PWM technique is known as modified sinusoidal PWM technique, and that may be 120 degree conduction or 60 degree conduction. So there are various PWM techniques that, if time permits, I will discuss. So today I have discussed sinusoidal pulse width modulation. There we have seen that if we are able to generate our switching pulses in such a way that the switching pulses are in proportional to the sinusoidal signal, then TSD of the output voltage will reduce and a better output voltage waveform we will get, and it will help in reducing the size of filter or inductor and capacitor. Then little bit we have discussed about modified sinusoidal pulse width modulation. Thank you.